You're listening to the audio production of Exile in Guyville. Stories by Amy Lee Lillard, published by Boa Editions and read by the author.
What men want, know what they'll pay for, that becomes the world. We're all whores from this. Every woman has a price tag on her somewhere. Everything she does, everywhere she goes, she's got a price tag hanging on her ass. This is how we learn to live. Candy Renee in the Deuce. Something has crossed over in me. I can't go back. Thelma in Thelma and Louise. For the women who have crossed over and can't go back. Exile in Guyville. In the museum, I had freshly laundered dresses laid out every morning. Breakfast oats and tea, fresh water for bathing. The patron did not see all this, did not witness my bathing or eating or dressing. The patron, most usually, would see me sitting in a rocking chair behind the glass, silent, pensive, docile. Or they saw me moving about my room, stretching my legs as a wild creature must. Or they saw me reading, sewing, napping, as a woman must. As a woman should. For this, the patron passed over money to the museum. They came from Kansas City, or across the state, or other states, even countries across the seas. They crowded into our vast exhibit hall lined with a rectangle of rooms like mine. They navigated the bustle and hustle of legs, arms, bodies, heads, other people breathing fog onto the panes, chirping laughs and maws of mouths. All to see me and the others behind glass. A display table sat outside my room, with a historical summary and a button to push. The visitors pushed this button if they wished. The voice that came from pushing that button purported to be mine, but in truth it was some other woman's voice. The voice let words fall from her tongue as if they were chewed and mashed in her teeth and gullet, made into a goopy paste, and regurgitated to the baby birds of her nest. Also, they may swallow it easily. My name is Temple, the voice that was not me said. I come to the museum from the year 1870. Such a small collection of words meant to tell a story. Yet still the visitors, all of them firmly rooted in their storied present of 2074, oohed and aahed while staring, examining, leering. One night a week, we were allowed out. All of us, off our stages and into the vast central space of the museum, on the other side of the glass. There was dancing, though the music was oddly heavy and mechanical, and no musicians in sight. There was drinking, tall glasses of pink liquid that made my head light. But more than anything, there was talking. I'm Charity, said the egg-white socialite from 1901. I'm Willie, said the sky-black singer from 1924. I'm Fortuna, said the earth-brown seafarer from 1794. I found myself touching the other women's shoulders, their forearms, as if to confirm they were real, and this whole museum with them. Willie and Fortuna and Charity and more, Sandra the widow from 1813, and Elizabeth the actress from 1936, and others from so many times. All of us young, no more than 25. And every so often, someone new. One of the women would disappear off to her new life in the brave new world outside, the one we were promised, the one we had not been allowed to see yet. A new girl would take her place. I talked to all of my fellow freaks, touched them, and they touched me. I grabbed their hands after a few drinks of pink and ran in circles, danced, stretched my legs as we couldn't during the week. As the nights grew long, I saw men by the main entrance doors. Long, tall, large men in gray and black suits, thick ties, trimmed beards, wide belts, chatting with one another, drinking decidedly unpink drinks, but mostly looking at us. "They call this night of ours Friday Night Art," said Willie on one of my first nights, still drunk with time lag, legs shaky from this ground that seemed to swim underneath me. "They're donors to the museum," Charity said, "guests of the curator. To me, they appeared as all the other patrons, giants, everyone in this time so tall and thick, grubby hands on glass, looking upon me, us, as if they could eat us whole." There was the daily routine of oats, new dress, washed face, sitting, reading, sewing, napping, noise, evening, meat, chat, sleep. There was the weekly routine of talking, drinking, being watched, with a different, molded intensity than that of day. There was also a monthly meeting when a red-uniformed woman came to fetch me for a meeting with the curator. When I first met her, in a green wood centuries ago, she appeared as a fairy, with golden locks, glowing skin, a dress that covered all but showed every curve. A supernatural being, the only language I had for a woman such as her, one that belonged somewhere else besides my time. In our monthly meetings, in her office filled with chrome and lilies, scented by lavender and something musky, I sat across from the curator. Her hair was darker here, her skin freckled, her pants trim and tight. She asked me questions. Was I feeling better? The hole could scramble us, body and brain, after all. Was I enjoying the weekly parties? Are the others enjoying the parties? What do the others say? What else have you noticed? I understood that she aimed to make me watch, listen, report, become a spy of a sort. To what purpose, I didn't yet know. I told her easily observable things, stories she probably already knew, like Willie performing a dance for us at our last Friday event, one she'd said she performed on a stage in Chicago and New York. Or Fortuna demonstrating how to puncture a jugular as she'd done on ships she'd pirated with her husband off the Atlantic. Sometimes, the curator would ask me about my life before. At first, the questions confused me, repetitive as they were, almost as if she forgot the freak show, that entire night in which we met. Ratty, smelly tents on dusty ground, the land ground down by carriages and foot traffic, a no man's land between farms and city. I'd begged the boy to take me to the show, the latest boy, his name Tristan and his name unimportant. We saw a bearded woman and a strange reptile-like man with hands like fins, and a young girl who could contort herself as if she were made of string. We saw an enormous man as big as a house, and another man who was but bones with a bit of skin. We saw a woman with an extra arm growing from her middle. We saw bodies with art bled into them. We saw oddities and freaks made so by outsized bodies and extra limbs, by the strangeness of their physical flesh against the norm, all of them on their own little stages. We walked through the show, oohed and awed, tittered and pointed. I remembered that later with disgust. Then Tristan and I snuck behind the tents, my lips soon fat from kissing, my chest wider and full of air without the restrictions of ties and bodices and corset, my womanly parts swollen and hollow from the boy plunging into me, promising me marriage and family and anything at all as his body contorted. I wanted none of that, at least not from him. I wanted him gone the moment he was spent. I excused myself to squat behind a tree. That is where the curator found me. "Do not be afraid," she said as I turned. She, able-bodied yet freakish, because she was something other than me, of the grimy baby city of Kansas, of the community of farms and settlers and lame Confederate and Union soldiers hiding from the world outside the city. A fact I could see immediately, yet could not say what told me so. "Is this part of the show?" I said, looking for a small stage, a curtain, a poorly concealed apparatus of some sort. The woman laughed, a thin sound that she followed with a wide smile. her teeth so white as to gleam in the night, skin pulled tight against her bones, hair made of light framing her face. "Do you seek to see strange things?" she said. "Or do you wish to have your own stage?" I stared, then understood I stared, tried to stop, stared still. "Your life has been hard," she said, her voice honey and arsenic. "Life is not but hard," I said, thinking of parents dying young, of running to the city to live, of stealing and sewing to make money, of the rarity of moments like this, in a peaceful copse outside this city of grit and offal. "You want," she said, her bones in her face showing through her stretched skin. "No harm in wanting," I said, even as I knew the uselessness of dreams in waking or sleeping. "Life can be different," she said. "With Jesus Christ our Savior, or perhaps a tonic of your making." "I do not offer God or poison," she said. "I offer a life of the future." "Ah," I said, "one of the territories then, gold in the hills?" The curator pressed a thin band around her wrist, and the air shifted and split. A hole appeared, a circle in the air with what seemed to be water falling over it. A sound came with the hole, one that set my teeth against one another, and a smell of things that should not burn. "I gather women like you," she said, "women who want more. People all over the world will come to see you." I had thought nothing of my future. Life was now, this moment and the next, and the need that connected them, the needs of the body, food, sleep, fornication. The last, something sinful, I was always told, yet necessary nonetheless. The feel of hands on my body, making it real. 200 years from now, she said, Kansas City is clean and shining. It is a place to thrive. She spoke of time, but I only thought of place. City meant gray streets and buildings, the color of soot and ash, of steel and industry, rusty red carving veins through the gray, the color of pig and cow blood, of the slaughterhouses. Flinty city women that dared not smile, and men with hats that let their eyes linger. But she described a different way of things. "There is another path for women like you," the curator said. I think this was the biggest lie she told me that night. In our monthly meetings, under light made by men, the curator appeared more human. Hair the color of peanuts, always pulled back loosely. Skin fleshier, her figure softer. She would ask about the things I'd done to survive back then. Because I saw no shame in it, I told her about the things I did for money, stealing silver, thieving wallets, occasionally mending clothing for the prostitutes downstairs in the carriage house, where I rented a small room. "Did you ever..." "I did not take money for fornication," I said to her unfinished question. "I did not judge the ladies for finding a means to stay alive," I said, "but I, well, I did not wish to engage in the dramatics and play acting that they must. That would quite ruin my joy in the sexual act." She laughed at that and asked about men. I told the curator about the things I did to feel alive, let a young man untie my trappings and release my breasts to night air. Let a young man kiss me deeply in dingy alleys and daylit streets. Let a young man pull up my skirts and find a hole to fall into. "Did you not think sex outside of wedlock a sin?" asked the curator, "as so many did in your time." "The world would have me be small," I said, "telling me to cover myself, to wear a corset, to shrink my body, telling me to marry whoever would have me, to become his property. Telling me to feel shame at joy, at pleasure, at the feeling of freedom. I would not be small." "Yet another sign you belong here," the curator said with a smile. At night in my small room in the museum, I dreamt of the travel I'd done. When the curator showed me her shimmery, watery gate to the future, I extended a finger to touch it. When I did, a force pulled at my hand. I panicked, with the mechanical roar of the hole vibrating my skull, the choking smell of sulfur and charred meat. I twisted, fighting the pull, turning back to look upon the curator, who merely smiled. I saw the freak show tense, the dark punctured with lamplight, the moon high above, and I reached myself back, if only because those tents, that lamplight, the moon, those were things I knew. But then I fell into a chasm of light and sound. I felt a rending as if I split down the middle, crown to toe, and were cracked open to the world. Then, just as the pain of such a rupture registered, pressed back together and sewed hastily with the roughest of wool fibers. I arrived in a sealed white room with men covered in white suits that moaned as they moved. They thrust me into a spray, water and gas, and stuck needles they called vaccines in my arms. All the light and pain. The curator appeared, and I did not recognize her. And for days, weeks, a terrible sickness. I have heard of the roiling that takes one out on the seas. The curator later told me of the floating, dunking sensation in the brain from machines that fly people from night to day. I felt both, my head and heart aflame, my stomach tied in ribbons, my legs as useless as a baby fawn's. All that and more to be encompassed in one line. My name is Temple, and I come to the museum from the year 1870. Do you see how written history is a lie? All of it. Beyond the machinery of the whole, the mechanisms of me coming here, there's so much living and dying behind the words and letters that survive. So much time. Days and nights, patrons behind glass, pointing, smiling, laughing. Men on the perimeters of our dances, staring. The curator, listening, nodding. Time moved surely and regularly, and I was comfortable and warm and safe. I did not have to hunt for money, for food. And so it was, after several months, I could truly think about what came next. I pictured a small, cozy room, somewhere in this promised land outside the doors, a city that was now green, free of smoke and stench, a place that welcomed me and I it. When next I saw the curator, I told her of my musings. She smiled with those teeth and said, "Which of them will you choose?" "Which?" I asked. "You are ready to leave here and start your new life," she said. "And all of the donors who've attended our Friday Night Art have expressed interest in you, so the choice is truly yours." My body had grown steadier through the months of living here, the time lag of memory, but now my ribs seemed to vibrate, my arms tremble. "Once you choose your husband," she said, "we can arrange everything rather quickly. You can be living in your new compound quite soon." "Husband," I said. The curator nodded. "No," I said, "you said the future was a place for women like me who wanted more." "On the arm of one of our very generous, very wealthy donors, you'll want for nothing. Life will never be hard again." I let time pass between that statement and my next, weighing the feel of that time, the understanding that came upon it. "You said nothing about a husband before," I said. Her mouth opened, growing wider, a caricature of a smile. "Is this," I said, "is this why you bring us here, to be sold to strangers?" "Temple," she said, "you're a smart, worldly woman. You know this is a fine arrangement. You are no stranger to men and their needs." "I won't," I said. "Let me out. Just let me free, out there. I'll find what I need. I'll take care of myself." "That's not possible," she said. "On your own, you'll be in extreme danger." "Why?" "Let me show you something, Temple." And then the curator took my hand, guided me out of her office, through a hallway I'd never seen, up a set of metal stairs, out onto a black roof. After months of living indoors, on light and air and food that seemed to come from unearthly magic, The sudden wind on my cheeks seared. I breathed deep, then coughed, hacking at something that seemed to lodge in my throat. The curator gave me a mask, which fit over my ears and covered my nose and mouth. The hacking stopped, and cool air, smelling of fire, flowed into me. Once I calmed, enough to hear her, the curator, wearing her own mask, said, "What do you see, Temple?" We stood at a railing on the edge of the roof. "I see," I said through the mask, my voice the pitch of speaking in a tin can. "I see... what do I see?" The curator then pointed to each item in my vision and named them in turn. "The sky," she said, pointing to a sickly, infected gray above. "The city," she said, gesturing to a devastated ground littered with machine parts and dust. Small, shrouded figures moved among the ash, the scurry of ants. "The train," she said, drawing her finger along an elevated track, covered in a giant, transparent orb. "What happened here?" I said, pointing to the ground beneath us. "What always happens," the curator said, "no matter what time you live in. Some thrive, some scrounge." I looked for the green I'd envisioned, the picture of the future she had painted by omission. I only saw gray. "This is a wasteland," I said. "The compounds," she said, a finger extended far in the distance to where the train led. "Private communities, safe from all of this," she said. "That is where you can live with a husband. They are nice, large homes, surrounded by gates and armed men." I wished to punch myself in the throat to cut out the heart that had been so eager to believe. "The men of the compounds," she said, "they need wives." "But the women of this time?" I asked. "They're all born with acid in their blood," she said. "From chemicals they breathe and eat, from the unrealistic promises of advertisers of culture. They are polluted, and they'll create polluted children." The edges of my eyes stung. I pushed back against the water, but it came nonetheless. "You will have a good life, Temple," said the curator. "You lied," I whispered, "and you lie now." Back to my room, back to patrons behind glass, back to routine, safety. The curator told me I could think, reflect, choose on my own time. So the next Friday night art, I watched the donors as they watched me. I saw how they stood, chest out, spine straight, feet forward. I saw how men of this future were a bit taller, hardier than men of my time. I saw how they were the same, too, how they were the ones who truly had choices. After, I slept in my comfortable bed with a full belly. It wasn't difficult to envision another, richer bed, a belly filled with meats and sweets I'd never known, a safe home far from the waste of the city, a shadowed figure in that bed with me, one that meted out delicacies. That figure, that husband, that benefactor, he would be kind and doting, or at least careful, treating me as a beloved pet. I would be a highly paid prostitute, and there'd be no shame in it. Or he could be callous, uncaring, looking upon me as a piece of art on his wall, an appliance in his home. That would not be hard either. I would be a thief, his thief, stealing all I could from him, as he did me. I looked about my room and out into the rest of the museum. Why create this, I wondered. Why all of this? Simply to snatch women for wives. Why have us spy upon one another? I understood.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.